Breaking Bad is a once-in-a-lifetime kind of show. It's universally praised and loved for its high intensity, its masterful writing, and of course, the epic dubstep montages. Breaking Bad was a very rare case in which a creative slow burner really got the time and money it needed to fully flesh out its story. And it ended up giving us one of the most unforgettable shows of our lifetime. Now, what if I told you there's a spinoff? Now, spinoffs have never really been a good idea in TV. For example, you have a media giant in Friends, and it's ending soon. I mean, how could this happen? My grandma loves Friends. It can't end now. So what do? You give the worst character on the fucking show 2 seasons on his own. So there was obvious skepticism when rumors floating around of a Breaking Bad spinoff, and there was even more skepticism when we found out it's a fucking Saul Goodman spinoff. Look, I loved Saul in Breaking Bad, but you have to admit, he is two-dimensional as fuck for the entire duration of the show. He does what a sleazy lawyer does, he folds under pressure, at times he looks like he's not cut out for this at all. So, how would an entire show based around him even work? Well, let me tell you. Better Call Saul is a prequel. With a prequel come some pretty obvious disadvantages, the biggest one being that you know where these characters end up. For example, in Season 6, Episode 8, Point and Shoot. Gus and Lalo are in the underground lab. Lalo has a gun and a camera pointed at Gus, but unfortunately, we already know how it's gonna turn out for Gus, so we're left with the obvious conclusion that Lalo dies here. It's moments like these that are so intense that kind of make me regret watching Breaking Bad first, which is exactly what a spinoff should achieve. In Better Call Saul, they actually managed to fully take advantage of the fact that this is a prequel by showing you completely different people than what you're used to from Breaking Bad. Jimmy, he's nothing like Saul when we first meet him. When we first meet him, he's a low-level lawyer working out of a nail salon that does very small-scale schemes to help out with his cases. You can see that he's hungry for more, he's shooting way above his league, consistently praying that one of his shots lands. He spends his days doing nothing but working cases and helping his brother Chuck out. And all of this is point A, the roots of Jimmy McGill. So how the fuck does he get to point B? A sleazy lawyer that's working on building a drug empire for Walter White. And that's where the show hooks you. They plant these Saul seeds here and there throughout the show, be it with his witty one-liners, his low-level schemes, his desperation to move up in the world. All of these seeds can be found very early on, and Better Call Saul makes it a point from season 1 to 6 for you to see those seeds grow slow and steadily. The tide is high, but I'm holding on. I'm gonna be... Now, let's talk supporting characters.
Have some more chicken. Have some more pie.
Chuck McGill, master of the law, but the things he does raises some serious moral questions, to say the least. Chuck is Jimmy's brother, and he has a condition that makes him sensitive to electricity. So he's been locked into his house for God knows how long, till he can see some actual improvement. Chuck is a partner at HHM alongside Howard Hamlin. Jimmy had worked there previously in the mailroom, but got constantly denied any actual opportunity to make something of himself at HHM. The relationship between Jimmy and his brother Chuck seems innocent enough at the start. Jimmy's having a hard time really putting his name out there. So Jimmy starts off bringing Chuck his groceries and his essential, and then he asks Chuck for some advice on how to really get this law thing started for him. This innocent relationship between two brothers turns into one of the most toxic relationships in television history, and it really starts at this moment in the show. Season 1, Episode 9, Pimento. Before we delve into that, we need some context. Jimmy, while working at the mailroom for HHM, managed to go through online classes and eventually pass the bar. He did this secretly as to surprise his brother with the great news. He tells his brother and Chuck is shocked. He then asks Howard if he can move into a more serious role at HHM, to which he's denied. He then finds this insane slam dunk of a case and pitches it to HHM, but then he finds out that Chuck told Howard not to hire Jimmy. Jimmy then confronts Chuck about it, and what we're left with is one of the most heartbreaking scenes in the show, where Chuck, the man who Jimmy idolizes, tells him straight up that Jimmy's not good enough and he should know his place in the world. From then, we see the most toxic game of chess unfold. Chuck trying to outdo Jimmy and Jimmy trying to outdo Chuck. All of this builds up to one of the greatest episodes of Better Call Saul, Season 3, Episode 5, Chicanery. The entire episode is a court drama as Chuck set up Jimmy to break and enter into his house and then chose to sue Jimmy. But what we didn't see coming was Chuck's eventual breakdown after Jimmy pulls off a scheme in court.
He'll never change. He'll never change ever since he was 9. Always the same. Couldn't keep his hands out of the cash drawer. But not our Jimmy. Couldn't be precious Jimmy. Stealing them blind. And he gets to be a lawyer? What a sick joke. I should have stopped him when I had the chance. And you have to stop him.
This moment feels like one of the most defining moments of anyone in TV. Chuck's entire downfall led up to and ended at this very moment. His reputation is shattered, he's being forced out of his company, and his relationship with his brother is completely unsalvageable, which brings us to Chuck's bitter end. Chuck is one of those characters that forces your opinion to shift whenever you see him. One minute you love him, the next you despise him. And by the end, you realize that he was never really wrong with what he said. He was simply wrong with how he said it.
Shut the fuck up!
Ignacio Varga, otherwise known as Nacho, is another new character exclusive to Better Call Saul. He's a slightly high-ranked member of the cartel who works under Hector Salamanca alongside Tuco, and if I could really boil him down to one word, it would be ambitious. Even though Nacho never asked for much, you can tell that he had big dreams. He really wanted that top dog spot, but that same ambition came to bite him right in the ass. Nacho's story arc is very, very similar to Jesse Pinkman. They were both in way over their heads so they could move up in the world, and it ended up costing them their lives. Another similarity is both of their relationships with Mike Ehrmantraut. Mike sort of took both of them under his wing because he knew how in over their heads they both were. And he could relate to that very much. This sort of formed two different yet strong bonds between Mike and Jesse slash Nacho. Nacho was one of the only guys in Better Call Saul that you can actually root for. What started off as a simple setup to get Tuco in prison somehow ended up as him working as a slave to Gus and forcing him to off himself. I think the episode that highlights Nacho the best is his last episode. Season 6, Episode 3, Rock and Hard Place. It is clear to us that Nacho is dying in this episode at the very beginning. The odds are overwhelmingly against him, he isn't in Breaking Bad, and this is the only way his father lives peacefully. We know this is a fact, but what makes this episode interesting is that Nacho knows this too. In this episode, we see Nacho come to terms with his impending death in the most heartbreaking way possible. The scene that killed me most is his last conversation with his dad. In the middle of nowhere, he manages to find someone who'd let him borrow a phone, and the first person he calls is his dad. And all Nacho really has to say is that he wanted to hear his dad's voice again. His dad is absolutely oblivious to what's going on, so he's giving him the turn yourself in spiel for the 1,000th time, and Nacho can't help but tear up. For the entirety of this call, he's been on the verge of tears, and his father was absolutely clueless. The tragedy in this scene alone almost perfectly portrays the tragedy Nacho has gone through this entire show. He fucked up once and ended up paying for it till the day he died.
Oh, hell no!
Now we move on to the behemoth that is Lalo Salamanca. Lalo is one of those characters where you can't even put into words just how utterly terrifying he is. He is by far the most psychotic character in the show, and yet somehow still manages to be the most calculated. Even up to his inevitable demise, you can tell that he knew what he was doing when he was bringing down Gus. His plan was almost flawless. But Lalo by himself was the catalyst of one of my favorite sequences in TV, the season 5 episode run of Bagman, Bad Choice Road, and Something Unforgivable. We start off with Lalo tasking Jimmy with picking up $7 million by the Mexican border to bail himself out. Jimmy drives out far into the desert and picks up the money from the Salamanca twins. He then gets mugged, but luckily, Mike is there to save him with a sniper, and then they both make their way out of the desert. And then in Bad Choice Road, Mike and Jimmy have been picked up by Gus's men, and they start formulating a story on why the pickup took so long. Lalo bought it at first, but as he was about to flee the country, Lalo at the last second decided to do a little digging. And there he found Jimmy's car face down in a massive pit. Lalo then confronts Jimmy at his apartment, but then the situation gets diffused by Kim. He then goes to Mexico with Nacho, which then leads us to the season finale, Something Unforgivable. Nacho had went to Mexico with Lalo to Lalo's home, and then late at night, when Nacho and Lalo were sharing a drink, Nacho leaves to open the door for Gus's hitmen to come charging in to kill Lalo. There's about 6 guys, and yet Lalo manages to kill them all and escape, knowing that Nacho had betrayed him. I mean, what a fucking way to end a season. And throughout it all, Lalo is as two-faced and villainous as ever. Every time Lalo shows up in a scene, the mood switches. He could either make a scene more lighthearted, or make it that much more menacing, or even sometimes, both. He's ruthless. He's unpredictable. You never know what his next move is, but what you do know is that it's gonna be fucking insane. Cinematography. It's rare that a show can use angles and colors to their advantage, let alone conveying whole subplots and narratives using just the camera. In the series finale alone, there are multiple shots that just convey the message beautifully. For example, when Walter White is asked what he would do if he had a time machine, he stalls for a while, but then he actually starts thinking about his regrets, and without saying a word, he just stares at the watch Jesse gifted him in Breaking Bad. There are plenty of moments like this throughout the show. We can even see the color palette slowly drop darker and darker as the seasons progress to where it eventually ends in black and white. But even when it's all doom and gloom, you can see these glimmers of color. Like whenever Gene looks at footage of Saul Goodman, you can see the color in his glasses' reflection. And the white shots in the show are just so beautiful. You can see whenever a situation gets tense, the camera just moves closer and closer in, making the scene itself feel tighter. And when the situation diffuses one way or another, we're left with a wide shot, which at times can feel like a painting of what just happened. No background music, no dialogue. All of these feelings are just expressed through cinematography. It is simply masterful. I wish I could really find the words that the cinematography in some of these scenes make me feel, but I simply can't. It's almost otherworldly how well the show was shot. There's a certain beauty to a very simple shot, such as when Jimmy and Kim share a cigarette in the HHM parking lot, and there's a certain horror in shots like the candle shot in Plan and Execution. Every detail is taken into account. It's like a science these guys have just completely mapped out. They know that if this specific thing is shot in this specific angle with this specific lighting, it will elicit a very potent emotional response from the viewer. And that, in and of itself, is absolutely genius.
If you like pina coladas, getting caught in the rain, if you're not into yoga.
Better Call Saul focuses on three main characters, those three being Mike Ehrmantraut, Kim Wexler, and Jimmy McGill / Saul Goodman / Gene Takovic.
Walter, put your dick away, Walter.
Mike in Breaking Bad was a badass. He showed no fear. He always knew what to do. Whenever he was on screen, you knew that he could deal with whatever gets thrown at him. But in Better Call Saul, he's still like that for the most part, but he feels more humanized here. He's still a veteran at doing sketchy activities such as spying, bodyguarding, and running Gus Fring's entire empire, but we catch these glimpses where he feels more down to earth. For example, when he finally opens up to his son's widow about how he really feels about his son dying.
He put me up on a pedestal. And I had to show him that I was down in the gutter with the rest of them.
I have never seen Mike this vulnerable and open. Better Call Saul gives Mike purpose. In Breaking Bad, we had no idea why Mike was Mike and why he's working like a slave as Gus's right-hand man. But in Better Call Saul, it's clear. He feels like he let his boy down. So he's doing absolutely everything in his power to provide for his granddaughter and make sure she has everything she could possibly need. You can see the love he has for her in just about every scene they do together. In a weird, twisted way, a parallel could be drawn between him and Walter White in that sense. Both started out doing this simply to provide for their families, but when enough was enough, they both still wanted more. Walt barely lived to realize that, but unfortunately, Mike didn't. Mike was given a clean out when Gus died. He had already made millions from working under Gus, and now that Gus is dead, there's no obligation and no reason to keep working. But I think secretly, Mike enjoyed being a hard nut that bossed around actual fucking gangsters, which ultimately led to his demise. In that same breath, Mike foundationally has a very wrong mindset. Instead of taking his son's death as the time to completely call it quits, which in fairness to him, it looks like he did for a while when he was working at the courthouse, but he still got sucked in when Jimmy started asking for favors, which then caused him to spiral down the same path he went down when he was a cop. Mike clearly understands what he's doing fully. We can see it in the Bagman flashback in Saul Gone. When asked what he'd do with a time machine, he said he'd go back to the day he took his first bribe. Mike saw himself as the bottom of the barrel, and he saw what he did for work as something that suited his own vision of himself. It's clear as day the level of hatred Mike has for himself after what happened to his son. He's given up on himself completely. He has no real regard for his life. The only reason he lives is to provide for his granddaughter. Better Call Saul offers many character-defining moments for Mike that ripple onto Breaking Bad. There's one in particular that really stuck out with me. Season 4, Episode 10, Winner. Werner is the mastermind behind the underground meth lab. Mike and him actually got along quite well. Mike would keep him company as he had to stay within the confines of a warehouse Gus had made for him and his crew. They could not be seen in public, and they couldn't connect with anybody in the outside world. Mike really cared about Warner and was pushing Gus to give them better working conditions, but Gus, of course, refused. One day, Warner grew completely relentless, as Mike hoped he wouldn't. And so Werner stuck out to meet up with his wife, who was flying in from Germany. Mike starts a manhunt and eventually finds him in the middle of nowhere. Werner fully understands what he's gotten himself into and what's about to happen. He tries to negotiate, but he doesn't fight Mike about this at all. He walks off hoping that Mike would just do it without any anticipation. And sure enough... this moment for me seemed like a huge turning point for Mike. This is where he kind of swears his loyalty to Gus. He could have just said that Werner got away and there's nothing he could do about it, but he chose to kill him. And you can see the pain in Mike as he wasn't entirely sure if that was the right decision. Better Call Saul gives us a very closer insight into Mike and shows that he too is a complex and deeply, deeply hurting character. Kim Wexler is, in my opinion, one of the best written characters in TV. Kim Wexler is Jimmy's partner in law, in crime, and in life. She starts off innocent enough working at HHM, building her way up to become partner. She's clean and on the straight and narrow path and never really strays away from it because she holds her career in such high regard and knows what could happen. And we can slowly see her descend further and further to Jimmy's level the closer she gets to him. She ends up leaving HHM and working at Schweikart. After some time, Kim kind of realizes that Schweikart isn't the type of firm she wants to work at. She then starts up her own firm alongside Jimmy, where she's doing everything herself and puts herself under so much stress that she ends up passing out behind the wheel and crashing her car. The big thing about Kim is that she bottles up everything. She shoves it deep down and doesn't let it out no matter what. And with that comes buildup. All of Kim's greatest moments on the show are when something builds up for way too long to where out of nowhere, she just has to let it all out. And that's when we see how troubled she's become since getting involved with Jimmy. She went from a near partner at a very respectable law firm to working pro bono cases to eventually just leaving law behind because she couldn't take it anymore. She got in way over her head when doing what seemed like small schemes with Jimmy and ended up taking it further and further, and then eventually she forever tainted Howard Hamlin's legacy and indirectly became the reason he had to die at all. We can see the culmination of everything that just happened. We can see the culmination of pretty much everything that happened in a beautifully heartbreaking scene in season 6, episode 12, Waterworks. She had just gotten on a bus after meeting with Howard's widow to fully explain everything that happened because the guilt had just eaten at her for all of these years. This is the same widow she lied to in season 6, episode 9, Fun and Games, where she told her that Howard's drug problem was nothing new. Even though Kim knew that it was a bold-faced lie, after sitting down on the bus and trying to shove the emotional baggage that was just handed to her, she simply couldn't. So she lets it all out and starts breaking in tears in the middle of this packed bus. She has fully realized that everything has been lost, and for what? For a kick? Howard never really even did anything that outrageous. He was just annoying at times, and she thought that him being annoying was enough to ruin his entire life. And then she indirectly made him lose his life. I don't want to say that this was all Jimmy's fault. I mean, we could see her plotting out shit to do to Howard by herself. She enjoyed this. Even though she'd never done it before, she wanted to go balls to the fucking wall. She even shocked Jimmy at times with how far she was willing to take it. I like to think that Jimmy was the gateway drug. She took it and she was hooked. She is one of the most tragic characters in TV. She lost control of herself, and her entire life crumbled and fell apart for it. Jimmy McGill, quite literally the star of the show. Jimmy McGill by nature is a schemer, highly intelligent, and not above sinking low to get what he wants. Throughout his 30s, he would go around with his buddy Marco, scamming to extort people out of their money, and that's all he really did. That was his purpose in life, up until his mid-30s. I can only imagine what that would do to a man. It's like partying every single day. It's fun and games while the party's happening, but it's fucking depressing the minute you get a moment of silence and get a chance to think about what the fuck you're doing. Jimmy sinks to a new low when he gets caught by the cops and pleads with his brother Chuck for a shot to start fresh and become a new man. Chuck reluctantly agrees and gives Jimmy all the resources to start fresh, and Jimmy takes this opportunity as a fresh start for him to work his way up from the bottom. But unfortunately for him, he simply cannot help himself. Even after turning his life around, to then passing the bar and starting up his own firm, to even getting himself a massive case that was going to pay him out millions, he still cannot help himself at all. It is true that almost everyone he worked with professionally was unfair to him, and he took that as an excuse. Well, if I can't go about this the right way, shit, what other way can I go about this? Even when he's doing actual legal work, he pushes how far the line between legal and illegal goes. For example, Season 3, Episode 5, Chicanery, again. To prove that Chuck was faking his illness, he gets Huell to plant a phone battery in Chuck's pocket when they're at the bar hearing. While technically, there isn't much illegal about this, it is still very, very sketchy. Jimmy also takes a keen liking for revenge. He even went as far as to sabotage his brother's career and reputation by making him lose a massive client, canceling his malpractice insurance, and absolutely humiliating him in a bar hearing. All of this because his brother didn't really believe in him. Even after he knew that his scheme pushed Chuck over the edge and made him kill himself, he still chose to fuck over Howard too, in a much more embarrassing way. And why? Because it's Howard. Literally, just because of the way he is, no particular event or nothing, just because Howard's a bit of an asshole, and yet, even through all of this, there is still something in the back of your mind rooting for him. And that, my friends, is what I like to call good writing. Jimmy is a parasite that drags everyone around him down to his level. Hell, he even brought down Chuck a few pegs. Chuck, the master of law, one of the most respected lawyers in Albuquerque, was about to fall to Jimmy's level, but chose to burn himself alive over doing that. Jimmy McGill is the perfect example of how not to go up against a system that's rooting against you. He used every dirty trick in the book, and look where it brought him. I would call Jimmy's story tragic, and it is, but when you really look at who's at fault with almost all of his shortcomings, it's him. He alone is the reason for 9 out of 10 of the bad shit that happens to him. Even when he was offered an absolute clean state as Gene Takovic, away from any connections to his life as Jimmy or Saul, he still could not help himself, doing the same shit he's been doing since he was a kid, stealing cash out of his parents' cash register. Which brings us to Season 6. Episode 13, Saul Gone. This episode, in my opinion, is not only the best episode of Better Call Saul, it is the best episode in all of television. Saul Gone. The jig is finally up. Saul Goodman is caught dead to rights by the cops, and just as he seems as irredeemable as he could possibly ever be, he sits down at a plea negotiation with Marie Schrader and flips the entire script to make him look like a victim right to her fucking face.
Mrs. Schrader, the loss that you've suffered, it's unspeakable. I met your husband a few times. He was a man who stood by his word and was very good at his job. He's a straight shooter. You and he are victims. And so am I.
And just when we think he sunk the lowest he can sink, he brings his sentence down from life plus 190 years to just 7.5 years. And in his terms, he requests a mint chocolate chip ice cream weekly. And in exchange, he was ready to sell Kim Wexler out. Just for weekly pints of fucking ice cream, it is indescribable how terrible this guy is at this point. But then, we get the court scene. He's in the home stretch. All he really needs to do is smile and nod, and he gets off pretty much scot-free. But then he takes to the stand, and finally, for the first time in the show, he's not only truthful to everyone around him, he's truthful to himself.
So yeah, I wasn't there when the meth was cooked. I wasn't there when it was sold. I didn't witness any of the murders, but I damn well knew it was happening. I was more than a willing participant. I was indispensable. I kept Walter White out of jail. I laundered his money, I lied for him, I conspired with him, and I made millions. If he hadn't walked into my office that day, Walter White would have been dead or behind bars within a month. And Agent Schrader and Agent Gomez and a whole lot of other people would still be alive. Fact is, Walter White couldn't have done it without me.
In one of the most dramatic scenes I've probably ever seen, he admits to everything, absolutely everything. He lets his conscience free, and you can see how much of a relief it is to him. He is fully ready to atone for everything he's done. Just when we think he can't get any worse, he doesn't. And he went out in the most true to himself way possible. He basically told the government that if he really wanted to, he could have very easily got away from this scot-free. And yet, he didn't. He wanted to finally be held accountable for his actions. And that is the best shot he will ever get at truly redeeming himself. Better Call Saul is many things. It's a love story. It's a law drama. It's a crime drama. Hell, you can even argue that it's a comedy at times. But when you boil it all down, you're left with Jimmy McGill, the man who's been fighting himself for decades. And when all was said and done, he finally fucking won.
Walter, put your dick away, Walter.